Why are you staring at me?
I'm not. I'm seeing you. Sometimes when you're really high, you see people. Or maybe it's when you're dying. But I see you. And I love you.
Hello, and welcome to episode 5 of the Three Body Podcast. We're your hosts, Dr. Maggie Aderin-Pocock.
And I'm Jason Concepcion.
And this is the official companion podcast for The Three Body Problem on Netflix. And today, we have some huge topics to cover as we delve into the true nature of the Santee and how humanity deals with this intergalactic crisis.
It's a global crisis. It's also a personal crisis. We're going to take a look at how they are processing Will's impending death with our production guest, director Jeremy Podeswa.
And with our guest expert, Dr. Michael Varnum, we'll be looking at the psychology behind an existential crisis and how we could respond to the confirmation of alien life out there.
I've been dealing with existential crises for a long time, Maggie. Before we go any further, y'all know the drill. Spoiler alert, we'll be covering episodes 6 and 7 of Three Body Problems. So if you have not watched that far yet, we suggest you pause the podcast now. Go watch the show on Netflix. We'll be right here waiting for you when you come back.
One of the things I really love about the Three Body Problem is that the characters seem real. They seem whole. We see them warts and all.
It really feels as if you're walking alongside these characters in that regard. And we talked about it up top a little bit. There's so much going on. Not only has the fact that alien life exists and is aggressively looking to colonize the Earth, not only has that news broken globally, but our main characters, the Oxford Five, are dealing with this immense personal tragedy, the loss of Will, all the kind of moments that, you know, escaped through their grasp like sand, the times that they were not appreciating each other. And it's heartbreaking, and have to deal with that while also some of them trying to organize some kind of defense to an attack that's coming, but also coming at the end of 7-8 generations of human lifespan. Like, it's not even going to happen in your lifetime. It's just a lot to take on. And it really makes you feel like, gosh, how would you even begin to tackle this problem?
I think as a gang, they're having a bad time, because it's just a crisis after a crisis. You're dodging one and then another one's running in. And so, but I'm fascinated how the different people respond to it. Because Augie's going through a sort of a moral crisis.
Yes.
Because they're using her technology in a way she had never conceived. That whole sort of Panama operation and sort of the emotional of, you know, seeing the children sort of dismembered and just knowing she's responsible for this in some ways.
I can't even imagine. And to have that be the culmination of your life's work, something really good and positive in her life, this pioneering technology, and then to see it used in that way. You know, I think Jin, it's very interesting to contrast Jin and Augie's responses, because I think Jin, while clearly shocked by Will's looming death and the revelations of the Santee invasion, is kind of grappling with the idea of defending humanity maybe a little bit more effectively than Augie.
I also wonder if Jin was in Augie's position and she'd seen the devastation of that. I don't know if her response might have been different, because I think when it's sort of out there or beyond, or you're not really tangibly sort of interacting with it, it's one thing. But when you see, you know, the toys and the kids and I think that might be different. But I do like Jin's approach. But also I think perhaps with Will's demise, sometimes I found this myself. When things are almost overwhelming and out of control, you take control by doing something that you can control, as sort of like the staircase project.
That's a wonderful point. And what a kind of power move by Jin to walk into a room amongst some really brilliant and powerful and established minds in politics and science in the military and say, hey, what about this really crazy idea? And that's exactly why Wade values her.
Yes.
Because of this completely out of the box thinking. And I think you're exactly right. It must feel affirming to, in some small way, be able to grab a hold of the steering wheel and say, okay, well, let me try and take control of events and point out a way that maybe we could fight back.
Yes. And it's quite interesting because the response of those scientists, you see them as all sitting there. Sort of, we need more research. We can't just jump into this. We haven't got time to sort of sit around.
Right.
And I think sometimes as the scientific community, we can have a bit of a latency, a bit of, well, you know, we should do this the proper way. And sometimes you just need to do it by the seat of your pants and see where it takes you.
Well, let me ask you, as a scientist, I mean, really what is happening here is Wade is opening, you know, the spigot of global resources in a way that I think has not ever been seen in human history. As a scientist, what could you do with that? You know, what could you do?
I mean, it's got close a few times, like the moon landings.
Right. Yeah.
Where suddenly sort of your resources were, we had to get the airman to the moon by the end of the decade.
Yeah.
So resources were suddenly made available. And I think as a scientist, I would find it sort of invigorating, but at the same time, absolutely terrifying. You know, you're given all these resources, and what if you fail catastrophically?
Yeah.
So yes, I think calculated risks, that's how I describe it. So you need to take risks, but you need to make sure that the risks are more likely to pay off, to come to fruition.
Yeah.
You don't just want to squander the money and say, oops.
You know, another thing I really latched onto with Jin is, you know, she's having all these tremendous personal problems in her relationship with Raj, this new perspective on her relationship with Will. And to deal with all that, partially, she's diving into her work. You know, the staircase project is, okay, well, let me try and push this aside and control what I can control. And I felt that was, I really empathized with that because I think that's something we all deal with at different times in our life. When things are going badly, it's like, well, okay, let me just put my nose to the grindstone and then push all that aside for a few hours or a few days.
That. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And even when Raj comes and speaks to her, it's okay, let's put that to one side. I've got to concentrate on this.
Mm-hmm.
And so I can definitely understand that. What do you make of Will's journey so far? Because it's been a roller. I mean, they've all had roller coasters, but his is extreme.
It's quite humane and it's heartbreaking in the sense that it feels so present, his longing and this feeling that he has very clearly that he thought he had more time. He's so young, you know, to be passing away at this age and to know it's happening and to have so many things that he thought he had more time to do. I got the sense from Will that he was looking for something else, a more passionate and clear life calling. And maybe he was treading water with the teaching while doing that. And also the missed chance with Jin.
Yeah,
to only discover the courage now, and only fleetingly even, to tell her how he feels when it's all over. It's heartbreaking.
Now, it's quite interesting talking about all that sort of angst that the Oxford Five are going through, but it's not just them, of course, that are dealing with this. We have impending doom and alien threat on all of us. The montage of news reports, I think, really sums it up nicely because it's sort of different people responding in different ways. You know, some people are, you know, burrowing down.
Yeah.
Other people are waiting for the aliens so they can join them. And it's sort of just interesting to see how different parts of humanity are trying to respond to that.
Yeah, and we see world leaders dealing with this challenge. We see clips of U.S. President Joe Biden, Prime Minister Rishi Sunak. Of course, a wide variety of responses that feel, I agree with you, it feels the variety of response to this immense challenge feels very real.
Yes. It's funny, it reminds me quite a bit of the COVID crisis.
Yeah.
You can see the scenes where in the shop and, you know, all the loo roll's gone. Actually, that might be a very UK thing.
No, we had that too. No, we had that as well.
But I did want to ask, if you did find out that your aliens were coming, how would you respond? Because I'm trying to work out what I would do.
Well, if it was 400 years from now after the shock wore off, I would probably do my best to get on with my life. One of the weaknesses of human perception and consciousness with regard to our ability to face challenges is anything that is a long way away. We're very good, personally and societally, with dealing with things when it's right in front of you.
Yes, tangible.
But anything that is tangible right here, but anything that's big and over the horizon is very, 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 very hard to deal with. And I think I would do the very human thing, which is say, that's somebody else's problem 400 years from now. I'm going to continue on with my life.
It's a bit like climate change.
Yeah, exactly.
Although we are feeling effects of it, it just feels, well, you know, it's still out there. Yes. But yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
I think I am a bit of a planner ahead, sort of a long-term strategist here. So what can I do for me, my kids, my kids' kids? I start thinking a few generations down, you know, what do I need to set up now that might help them, I think. I don't think there'd be anything I could do, but I would want to start thinking about it, I think.
And buy some land in New Zealand or some remote area, maybe, that the Santi hopefully would not be that interested
with. Yes, you know, and build an underground bunker. Start digging now, because it's going to take generations to get there.
Yeah. What do you think of the Stars Our Destination project in the show? Are there any parallels that you could see in real life? Is this something that you could see happening in real life?
Yes. There are various projects like Virgin Galactic, Branson, Musk, and people like that trying to get people into space. The Stars Our Destination, from what I see, this is just a fundraising exercise. And so they're selling these. I always love it when someone sells a star, because we don't actually own them. You know? Just because we can see them.
Do you have a ballpark? Like, what do you think the price is?
Well, I see. It depends if it's got exoplanets and if those exoplanets are populated, because I think that makes a whole new ballgame.
This is something I've been meaning to ask you again as a scientist. What are your first questions? Like this news breaks. You find out through your professional networks, your personal networks, what's going on. What are the first things you want to know? This news breaks. You want to find out what?
So I think I want to find out more about these aliens. Things like, what do they look like? You know, is our atmosphere compatible with them?
Yeah.
So if they arrived here, would they want to sort of, I would say terraform Earth, but if they did change Earth, would we be able to survive?
Right.
They were initially talking about sort of compatibility, sort of sharing our planet.
I'd be very wary of that deal, that anybody says, hey, we're going to come there against your will, make this trip across the vast expanse of space, but like, we can share the planet. Don't worry about it. I'd be, even if the bugs thing never came into it, I'd be very, very suspicious of such a deal.
Yes. And also, how many are coming? Because
we don't know.
Yeah, right? The scale of the Santee.
Would you offer yourself up as someone who could put their expertise towards defending Earth against the Santee? If such a thing happened in your lifetime, do you think you'd be like, well, I can help in some form or fashion, and I'm gonna try it.
If there was a capacity where I thought I could help, I think I would.
Right.
I think I'd want to inspire future generations to take on this challenge as well. And you could perhaps do it with PR. But I think the problem is it rapidly becomes propaganda, help Earth, fight the Santee.
Yes.
And especially because they have shown their hostile intent. Because I love science fiction. I'm always watching it as the aliens arrive and the first guy fires the gun. You think, no, we could have been friends. But that's not the case here. It just looks
certainly not the case. My help would probably amount to me buying 1/200,000th of a star.
Funds permissible. Yes. Yes. Just one of the twinkles or something.
Yeah, I think that's what something I'd go like for. That. Yeah. Maybe an asteroid, something in the Oort cloud out there, something smaller.
The thing is, you have a voice. You could really influence people.
Well, I mean, it's certainly, if I was a podcaster in this world, there'd be very little else to talk about after this news breaks for a significant amount of time. I think we would be everyone all around the world. In that sense, that idea of unity of cause, there is something appealing about that.
Yes.
But the idea that humanity for once could actually kind of get together and try and figure out how to meet a challenge in a way that issues you know, domestic politics, domestic economics, any kind of like small town political concerns, and put the needs of the planet above those things. There is something appealing about that, for sure.
Definitely. And I've always loved that idea that something unites the planet Earth.
Yeah.
And yet we put our differences aside. And well, unfortunately, I think the only thing that would unite us is sort of impending doom. And sort of
I think so.
A global scale. But yes. And so I think that would be very exciting.
So let's really get into one of today's topics by putting the emotional journey of the Oxford Five under the spotlight. I spoke to director Jeremy Podeswa about telling the story of these five brilliant individuals with a particular focus on Will's story. Jeremy, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
You've done so many different kinds of television shows and have directed episodes that occur at different places and the runs of those episodes. What does it mean to direct the episodes that are closing out the opening season of a show?
There is a really interesting thing that happens. There's a kind of like emotional build through the season, and it really comes to a head in the last couple of episodes. And so for me, that was an exciting and interesting challenge to just kind of, you know, take something which is, you know, in some ways it's a genre show that deals with an impending alien invasion. But it's really about human beings who are going through monumental human things. And the humanity of these characters is really what's the paramount thing. And, you know, what they go through and how they deal with situations of, you know, deal with their own mortality and deal with the fate of the world and all those things is, so, you know, it's really human scaled. And to me, that was very exciting in the last couple episodes to really kind of ground the show in that emotional reality.
I think one of those strands, those plot lines for me is, you know, Will and Jin in that moment where they FaceTime from the hospital. And of course, Will has had this, you know, long running, unrequited love for Jin that's now out in the open. How do you make sure you're picking up that thread to take it to the place that you want it to?
Well, you know, I'm obviously coming in to do the last two episodes, but I'm very familiar with what came before it.
Yeah.
And, you know, I've seen a lot of dailies. I don't think I saw anything cut together actually when I was shooting, but, you know, I had a pretty good idea of like where these characters needed to go by these episodes. And the script was very strong, you know, for Alex Sharp in particular, who plays Will and who dies in those last episodes. And, you know, he has a couple of very strong emotional scenes, one with his sister, who's like a supporting character in the show, but has a very powerful scene with her, and then very powerful scenes with Jin and with Saul, who are his closest friends. For me, like, these scenes are, they're end of life scenes. I mean, this is an end of life situation that's quite unusual, but, you know, if you root this in a kind of reality, it's really about somebody who's dying and leaving their closest people. And there's nothing more moving than that. And the writing was very, very beautiful for those scenes. And, you know, they're with such beautiful actors like Jess, who plays Jin, and Jovan, who plays Saul, and Alex, of course, who plays Will. Like, they're just such beautiful actors and have such great access to their emotional souls. And, you know, directing those scenes with them was really beautiful. And, you know, actors love scenes like that because they're everything. You know, they give you a chance to just kind of be so authentic and so real and so vulnerable and open and emotional. And, you know, it's the scenes as written were really a gift, I think, to all three actors. And I just think they just rose to the occasion so beautifully. Alex in particular, you know, was so committed to playing this role. And he, you know, his character has a disease where his body is wasting away, and he actually lost a lot of weight for this part. And I think, you know, you know, when you lose a lot of weight like that quite quickly, it's also has a psychological impact on you as well. And I think it makes you feel very vulnerable. And he just brought so much sensitivity and vulnerability to those scenes. They're just heartbreaking. I love those scenes so much. And I love the actors work in them.
And there's a wonderful interconnection of, you know, the cosmic and the intimate at the end of this episode where Will is ready to die. He imagines that beautiful scene of the paper ships going out to sea. He's ready now. And he goes and buys the star for Jin. Tell us about creating that scene.
Well, I think buying the star for Will is such a Will thing to do. in that, you know, he's somebody who doesn't express his emotions easily and he, in a way, has to find a substitute to tell somebody how much he loves them. And his way of doing it in this case is to do something crazy and spend millions of dollars on a star for the woman he loves. And I think it's a gesture that doesn't allow her any possibility of not reciprocating his love, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
It's like if he would tell her he loves her, he might risk her saying that she doesn't love him in the same way. And he can't handle that. And I think that just giving her this incredible gift as a gesture is just the most selfless thing that he could do, which is basically saying, in effect, it doesn't matter if you love me as much as I love you. This is how much I love you. I love you this much. Like, I would spend every last penny I have on you. And I would do something where your star will endure forever, as our love will endure forever. And that's the grand kind of gesture that he can make. And I think it's a beautiful thing.
We really see the impact of Will's illness on his friends and how they all deal with it in different ways. How much did you and the actors talk about the way to present those emotional responses, whether it's Jin just becoming so devoted to Will in a such a touching way, or Saul kind of, turning to the flesh and to having fun in a weird way, but also being there for him? How much did you talk about those different responses and how to present them?
We talked about it a lot, actually. You know, it was with the guys, like for Jack and Saul, it's like they're kind of like a brotherhood. You know, they've been through a lot of stuff together. They're very, very close male friends. And, you know, I think it's like your brother is dying. And, you know, that when Will has his operation, he wakes up, the two guys are there for him. Like they're family, right? And these guys actually are quite, you know, kind of separated from their own real families, their blood families. And so they don't have really strong familial ties. So their family is really each other. And they have their interest in science that they really share. They have their education history, their pal history, their colleagues, their friends, their everything to each other. And so, you know, it's easy, I think, for those actors to imagine how they would deal with that situation, because it's like dealing with your brother. And we see that really clearly. It's a kind of uncomplicated, simple love that they have for him, for Will. And, you know, it can't be diluted by anything. They're just there and they're present for him.
Yeah.
I think with Jin, like it's complicated because she knows that Will loves her more than she loves him, really. She's very close. She's part of this fraternity that also includes Augie, like the Oxford Five. You know, they're all buddies. But, you know, this kind of romantic entanglement makes it a little more complicated for her. And then it's further complicated for her because she also kind of wants him to be in the staircase project, you know?
Right.
And so there's a kind of a complicated thing for her, because she does love Will in her own way. And it's a really meaningful love. And I think in the end, she realizes how much he means to her. And I think it's so painful for her to ask him to be in this project, which is basically to risk this huge unknown. Like, if he puts a part of himself in this rocket ship, and who knows what will happen if the aliens get to it. And, you know, she might be, you know, committing him to some kind of purgatory that's just horrible. But also there's a potential from a scientific perspective to really make a gigantic difference for humanity, which she wants to be a part of. And so for her, it's super, super complicated. You know, she loves Will. She also wants him to be involved in this project. She doesn't want him to be involved in this project. she doesn't want him to possibly have some horrible fate as a consequence of this project. But at the same time, she knows it could also go the other way and could be the most important thing to ever happen to the world. In the end, I believe that if Will had said, no, he doesn't want to do it, she would never have pushed him into this thing, because her love for him is bigger than the other thing.
I was really moved by, you know, how infectious the feelings of protectiveness that Will's friends have for him kind of like seep out of the screen. I'm thinking of the scene where Will's sister and brother-in-law come and in a very kind of callous way to essentially hit him up for money in his last moments.
You said yourself you're dying. So we came to ask you, since you don't have anyone.
Who says I don't have anyone?
Well, do you?
I might. What if I love somebody?
Well, whoever she is...
Maybe it's a he.
Whatever. I don't care what they are. If you have someone, you haven't had them for long. And we're your family, Will. Maybe not the best family, but here we are. And whatever Mum left you, it should go to us.
Why was it important to have that scene in there? I found myself just gripping my armchair thinking, how can you do this?
Oh, I love that scene so much. As a director, I have to say, those scenes they're really risky because you have these two characters who come in for one scene.
Right.
You don't know anything about them. And you have to build off of that scene an entire family history for Will. And the great thing is that the writing of that scene and the acting in that scene are so great that you understand everything you need to know about how Will grew up, what his relationship with his family was, what his relationship with his sister is, what it was, what it currently is, and why Will is the person that he is. Like, you get all that in one scene. It's an amazing thing, actually.
Yeah.
And what the scene does is really puts into relief how important this Oxford Five thing is to all of them.
Uh-huh.
Because it's not about blood tie sometimes. It's not about genetics. It's about chosen family very often.
Yeah.
And, you know, your people are your people. And we see that, you know, Will's blood relatives are not his people. And I think we kind of know that as we watch the show, but now we really know it.
Yeah.
And it's very moving, I think, to see like why these people are so important to the Oxford Five, because that's all they got.
Just returning briefly to the scene where Will is imagining himself in the paper boat, I wonder if you could tell us how you created that scene. What was it like to shoot that, the VFX in, and what was on the page? Was it as you read it on the page?
It's pretty much as described. But the thing is that
when you're
sort of conceiving of a sequence like that, it's like it's such a surreal, dreamlike moment. It's like, you know, there's always a editorial choice in terms of like, how much of a dream do you want to make this? Like, how grounded in reality is it? How dreamlike is it? Does it feel really abstract or does it feel kind of real? Like, we've seen these paper boats, you know, real size, origami size, you know, in an earlier episode.
Yeah.
And now we're seeing like a huge one that he's like sitting in. It's such a sort of fantastical idea. But, you know, we're not making Willy Wonka. We're doing a different kind of show. And you have to be moved by it. So I think like that, for me, that's sort of what dictated the choices around this, is that whatever we did, it had to be beautiful and sad and moving and eloquent and poetic.
Oh.
It couldn't be sort of vulgar or tacky or, I don't know, whimsical. It had to be something really, you know, that had a level of poetry about it. And so, you know, that I think dictated a lot of the choices and how we did it. So we filmed it as a visual effects sequence, you know, with a real paper boat, large size paper boat with Will inside it, and real rain landing on him. But then we extended rain with visual effects.
Wow.
But you know, we had to have interactive rain falling on him.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, we did lots of testing on like the speed of rain and how to film it so the rain would look like rain and not look like something else. And where does all the water go that we're pouring in the studio? And, you know, there's lots of very, you know, technical things to sort of figure out. And then just the sort of overall quality of the visual effects that are going to lend at this level of poetry. So we filmed it with, you know, a number of cranes in the studio to do these beautiful moves that are very kind of poetic and dreamlike. And, you know, there's lots of discussion with Alex about his performance. Like, how does he react when the rain falls on him? Or does he know he's in a dream? You know, all these kinds of things. Does he know he's dying? Because, you know, this is really about him dying. So it's all these things. But I think Alex just did such a beautifully touching, simple performance of that without going too far. We didn't want it to go into melodrama or it's its own thing.
Yeah.
And the guiding thing was subtlety, poetry, delicacy, emotion. That was it.
The penultimate episode, Dr. Yi returns to Red Coast Base. And where she first made the phone call to the aliens.
Yeah.
And it's a really interesting and subtle scene. Does she ever, for a moment, regret what she has done? Because there were times where I thought, okay, now she does feel like maybe she made a mistake. But here at the end, I'm not so sure. I think it felt like she was steeling herself for what's to come.
I think her journey from this like young, disillusioned girl who's ready to see humanity go down the drain because of what she feels that they haven't earned the right to exist any longer in a way, where she arrives at when she goes back to Radar Peak and sort of has to contemplate the consequences of her decision at the end is very moving, I think. And the fact that she's lost her daughter through this process and in a way lost her faith too in her mission is, I think, a very powerful personal journey. And I think Roz, who plays Rosalind Chow, has done like a beautiful job of really sort of making that connection between the younger actress who plays her character and her. And we really understand the full history of this character and what, you know, time has done to her. And I think, you know, when she ends up where she ends up at the end of the episode, it is really moving because she has to really look at her life in this like larger way and what her role is in humanity and what her role is in the course of the destiny of the world. It's big. And she's had a huge role to play in what is happening. And there's a lot of pathos in that and complex feelings and, you know, a lot of loss and hope and, you know, very conflicting things for her. And I think we're, you know, even though she did set this whole thing in motion, I think we're really moved by what happens to her at the end and the fact that she's not going to live to see whether this was a good thing or a bad thing. And the very thing that she put into motion is the thing that actually is going to kill her and also killed her daughter. And there's a lot of pathos in that, I think. And so I find those scenes really beautiful. And I think that the metaphor of Radar Peak and its decay over the years and the satellite dish now being a ruin is a metaphor for something. You know, it's a metaphor for this, you know, with this grand vision that you have of the future and what it might be and what it actually now is. And, you know, is this the way it's going to end with everything or not? And I think that's the big question that the episode asks. And, you know, it's a very interesting through line for a character from the very beginning, when she's a young girl in China and going through these huge historical events to where she is now.
Do you have a favorite moment in the episodes you directed that we haven't talked about yet?
I don't know. I guess for me, like always, like the things that move you the most are the things that are the most meaningful. And I think it is funny being a show that's this big, because then it is a huge show that like two people in a hospital room in the end for me is like the most powerful scene. And for me, it's the Saul and Will scene in the hospital, which, you know, it gets me every time. I'm really moved by it.
How many was it? It's four. The next one is the last one. You know, maybe it won't be as bad as all that. Maybe it'd be like I'm a pet to them. Or maybe I'll be like entertainment.
What do you do for entertainment? What's your favorite movie?
The Shining.
I got a little teary shooting it. I got a little teary editing it. And I just think the actors are so great and the writing is so good. And it's just, you know, it cuts through everything. You know, it's however big the show is in the end, it's really just about two people in a room. And, you know, I think if it works on that level, which I think it really does, then the show has meaning, you know?
It's a wonderful scene. Well, Jeremy, thanks so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
So a massive thanks to Jeremy for that insight into the filming of the very human stories that are taking place within Three Body Problem. Now let's zoom out from these intimate moments and think about the effects that an impending alien invasion might have on humanity.
That's right. Maggie was lucky enough to chat with Michael Varnum, an associate psychology professor at Arizona State University, who recently co-authored a psychological study on Americans' reactions to the potential reveal of alien life. He's also part of the university's interplanetary initiative, which seeks to investigate humanity's possible future in space.
Michael, thank you so much for joining us and welcome to the show. Now, can you introduce yourself and tell our listeners a bit more about your work?
My pleasure, and thank you so much for having me on. So my name is Michael Varnum. I'm an associate professor of psychology at Arizona State University, and I'm also director of the social psychology program here. So my work generally focuses on how ecological factors, so things like climate or population density or disease threat, affect human behavior and influence our cultures. But my interests are pretty broad. I've also done work on things like stereotypes, empathy, factors that make pop songs successful. And I think the reason I'm here today is I've studied how we'll react to finding out we're not alone in the universe.
As space scientists, we study life in the universe, and we study sort of what's out there. But I didn't realize that psychologists do this.
You know, the truth is not many psychologists have done anything about this. We're just sort of starting to.
New field.
Yeah, new field. And I read something the other day that I found really fascinating. This was by Eric Hazelton in Psychology Today, that some psychologists are beginning to think of themselves as exopsychologists, trying to found a discipline of trying to think about what would the minds of aliens be like? How would they work?
How can you do that? Because the possibilities are endless.
But for example, in evolutionary psychology, which is sort of my theoretical lens, we think about how sort of features of being human, like having a lifespan of 100 years or having an extended period of childhood, or you know, the fact that men and women differ in the number of offspring they can have and how much investment is required or typical to keep them alive, that we can start with these sort of facts about our species and then derive predictions, right, about how we're going to interact with others, what our goals might be, what the strategies we employ to accomplish them might be. But what if we imagined a species with very different parameters? One that lived for 1,000 years and reproduced asexually. Or one, for example, like the Santi, that was incapable of deceit or the use of metaphor. So a lot of our social cognition is designed around trying to deduce whether another person is being honest with us. What if we didn't have that adaptive problem? How might we work differently? And so these are kind of fun thought experiments, but by thinking about those parameters, this might actually give us some more insight into our own psychology as human beings.
Now, you were part of a research team that actually investigated humanity's response to the discovery of microbial life. What did you find out?
We've run now several studies, maybe around 4,000 participants. And in kind of the first batch, yeah, we were focused on this question of, if we find evidence of alien microbes, right, how are we going to respond? And so to look at that, we asked people, you know, okay, here's a hypothetical scenario, right? People, scientists have discovered these microbes on another planet. How do you think you'd feel? And we analyzed the kind of language they used in free responses using a computer program. And we found that there seemed to be more positive emotional content than negative. And that was the same thing we saw when we asked folks more directly. And we also found these same kind of results when we gave people an old New York Times article. Remember back in 1996, right? Bill Clinton announces, you know, we're not alone in the universe. Scientists have found evidence of these fossilized microbes on a Martian meteorite. So we had people read that and again, sort of react to it. We saw the same thing. And since we published that first paper, we actually ran these studies again in a bunch of different countries. So the first studies are with Americans. But in places like Mexico, Spain, the United Kingdom, and South Korea, we generally saw the same kind of pattern, more positive than negative responses. And we also asked folks about, okay, what if it's not just germs that we discover or fossilized microbes, but evidence of an alien civilization? And there too, we saw the same kind of thing, at least in response to this framed as a hypothetical. Folks believe they would feel happier about it as opposed to sort of scared or upset or uncertain.
It's funny, I find that really heartening because I love science fiction. And usually when the aliens arrive, the response is, oh my God, you know, kill them. And so the fact that the responses, even to sort of intelligent alien life, is quite positive from individuals gives me sort of a, I don't know, more faith in humanity, maybe?
Oh, I mean, absolutely. And that was my take on it, too, when I saw the data. And it also made me wonder a little why in fiction our depictions of contact are often so negative. But I think maybe one thing we do in the stories that we tell, in the movies that we make, in the television series, is sometimes we use fiction to kind of play out some of our worst fears, our nightmares. So the three-body problem, right? This is a nightmare scenario. This, you know, highly developed, far superior alien race is coming. There's seemingly nothing we can do about it, and they're bent on destroying us. And in a way, it might make sense that we would use fiction to play out not the sort of happiest scenarios we could imagine where, oh, and it was just like meeting people from another country. We established trade. We're now kind of used to each other, and we have the sort of normal bickering and friendships and exchange of cuisine and fusion of cultures, which, you know, hopefully is what would happen. But instead that we use it to play out more dire scenarios, maybe as a way to have like a risk-free way to simulate them, to war game them. What would we do? How should we respond? You know, I have some colleagues who argue that that's one of the perhaps foundational functions of fiction, so to speak.
And also, I guess there's not much drama in sort of, the aliens are our buddies. But yes, it's much more dramatic if, you know, something awful happens and, you know, there's an existential threat as there is here.
Oh, absolutely. Or imagine they're really boring. You know, they're the dinner guest who just won't leave and keeps telling this long-winded story.
Yeah.
So now I actually want to write a short story like this. Yeah.
With the Santee in particular, because of the eye in the sky and, you know, you are bugs, I mean, it really sets the tone. And so it does present a sort of an existential crisis for humanity. It's sort of such a potent threat. I suppose on the risk register, sort of impact is high, even though it's a long way away. So how does that compare with sort of real world crises like such as climate change and nuclear war? Can we put that into perspective?
You know, it's interesting. Climate change is maybe a somewhat useful analogy here. So we are already feeling some of the effects. I mean, I live in Arizona and we've had, I think, the hottest year on record. You know, over 100 days, over 110 degrees Fahrenheit, which I'm trying to think of my Celsius, but I think it's around 50 or so, maybe higher. And so just humans aren't really meant to survive in these conditions. You can't be outside very long. But when we think about these projections for the future, right, what does 50 years out from now look like or 100 years? Those are really scary. And I think, you know, maybe this is a somewhat good analogy because we, like with the Santi and the eye in the sky, we are experiencing some of the effects now. It's not just this sort of prophecy or projection of what will come.
Yes. I've worked on satellites that sort of monitor climate change and things like that and spoken about it to the public. And sort of maybe sort of 10, 15 years ago, I think there was still quite a bit of skepticism. But now it seems to be sort of brought home. But with the Santi, I suppose people all saw the eye in the sky, so they know that it doesn't feel as if someone's making it up. And I suppose that has an impact. The fact that, yes, we know that this is going to happen.
Yeah, I think, you know, denial would be pretty difficult under those circumstances. You know, back in the 1980s, Ronald Reagan gave a speech at the United Nations where, and this is sort of height of the Cold War, where he said something to the effect of, you know, I wonder how our differences, our current, you know, conflicts and struggles would melt away if we were faced from a threat beyond this world. And I think that's also baked into the movie Independence Day. So, you know, when you see that sort of cooperation at the level of governments and across societies, I don't think that's so far-fetched that when if a threat is big enough, you know, research suggests then our sense of we and us, you know, goes beyond our own sort of national or ethnic groups and starts to become the human species. So that might be one thing I would suspect might happen. But again, who knows? We haven't really had a trial run for this. We haven't,
which is probably a positive thing.
I would tend to think so, right? We're all still here, so yeah.
And I must admit, I've spoken about that in the past, that we need a sort of a threat of a magnitude that will make us work together. And it's funny, COVID seemed as if it could be that. Climate change sometimes feels like that, but we're still not quite united yet.
Well, and probably it wouldn't be, you know, exact or perfect, right, in terms of the sense of unity. There's going to be individual differences and responses, one would imagine. Something that might be sort of relevant, a friend of mine, Josh Jackson, did a study a few years ago where he had people read stories about how automation and AI was going to take their jobs. And then he asked about prejudice towards various, you know, ethnic, religious, racial groups that weren't their own. And this threat of job-stealing robots tended to tamp down prejudice towards other human groups.
Yes, because it's the robots taking over, not...
Right, so now the robots are all of our enemies, right? And this coalitional psychology kicks in where our differences are small compared to ChatGPT or this terrible robot arm or this self-driving taxi.
The next scene I'd like to discuss is sort of three of the Oxford Five, your Augie, Saul, and Will, are watching TV in the local shop. Now, the local shop has been stripped of nearly everything. I think there's a few pot noodles or something left behind.
Right.
But on the TV, they mention this new fundraising initiative, you know, the stars are destination, with billionaires buying up rights to sort of stars within our galaxy.
I don't get it. It's a fundraiser for the war effort. Bake sale for billionaires.
People make donations and somehow we're going to catch up to the little green men and put a giant eye in the sky.
Just they're doing something.
You know, some people are worshipping the aliens. That's something.
We should be using that money to help people right now. Not fund a war that's not going to happen until 2400.
It's a good story, though, isn't it? It's much more exciting to imagine a future war of the worlds than it is to muck around with our current problems.
I just want a beer. Any beer.
We see a different response from each of them here. But what sort of reaction do you think we might see in the real world in a situation like this?
So part of it, you know, might have to do with differences in personality or people's own idiosyncratic past histories. Some of it might have to do with the sort of threats and opportunities this might mean, which would differ as a function of, say, whether we're close to death from terminal cancer. So for Will, you know, his own end is assured. It's coming soon. And it might make sense that, you know, a way of trying to leave a legacy or look forward would be, you know, to do something now that might have an impact in the future. But I think, you know, we see some of these debates too about, you know, plans for space exploration and colonization, right? Elon Musk and others say we need a plan B. So we need colonies on, you know, the moon and on Mars in case something happens to the Earth. And that resonates with a lot of people, but with a lot of other people, that seems ridiculous. We have such big problems now and here. Why aren't we using the resources to deal with them? Because it would take massive amounts of resources to set up viable colonies elsewhere. And so I think that debate, you know, resonates a lot with some of the arguments people have had about, you know, funding space exploration or funding these colonization plans.
And I think that is classically shown because Ajin wants to sort of, you know, take action and sort of fight the aliens. We're all saying to yourself, look, that's out there. Let's sort of focus on today. I guess that's the sort of response we might see from different sort of people in different walks of society.
Well, and you could argue we see that to some extent with things like climate change, right? There are people who say, well, you know, the economic costs of going green, the jobs that would be lost, right? We have problems to deal with right now. Yeah. And what about those? Why should I worry about something that, you know, okay, maybe the Earth is going to become a hellscape in 100 years, but that's 100 years. And, you know, I've got my concerns right now.
Yeah.
And I think that's actually pretty human.
And so why do you think that we as humans are drawn to the idea of aliens out there? Because it just seems to be a sort of like one of the fundamental things. If we look back through time, you know, people have looked up, we've always suspected there's something out there.
You know, I think we're an incredibly curious species. That's one sort of base feature of humanity. We want to see what's over the next hill, right? I mean, we're the only ones that we know of so far that's actually left our own atmosphere. And we put people on the moon. I'm fairly certain we'll put people on Mars. We've sent probes out of the solar system. It just seems to be a built-in drive in our species. And, you know, if we think about, you know, where human beings live just on this planet, even in Antarctica at any given time, there's hundreds of people working at the research stations. So this seems to be part of who we are. But I think as we sort of know more about how the universe works, you know, space is vast and cold and, you know, it's mostly space. It's mostly empty. We're not floating in some, you know, pudding like ether. And it's really big and it's really old. And we've been here for sort of, you know, the blink of an eye in cosmic terms. And we're going to be here for another blink of an eye probably and no more. That can be pretty heavy, maybe a little scary, maybe a little depressing, maybe thinking that we're not alone sort of softens the blow of that.
Oh, I rather like that idea. It's funny because when I think of the cosmos, I feel it's nice to be part of something amazing. And as you say, our time on Earth is so brief. It's nice that there's a sort of a longitude. We might be just passing through, but yeah, the universe continues. Has watching this series sparked any ideas about what you'd like to investigate next?
Yeah. So, you know, watching the series, it did make me think a little bit about trying to play a little with different kinds of contact scenarios. And also, you know, we sort of just measured how people's emotions would change in response to learning we're not alone. But it might be interesting to look at, you know, how might that shift things like how folks feel about members of groups that they don't see as their own, or their willingness to cooperate with other people in general. So it might be cool to test some of this out and maybe also delve a little more into who are the folks who wouldn't feel great about this and why.
Yes. That sounds fascinating. That's what I love about science fiction. It just opens up literally worlds of possibilities. And yes, lets our thoughts wander and explore.
But absolutely. Your
work just sounds absolutely fascinating. And so, yes, thank you so much for speaking to me today.
My pleasure. Thank you so much for having me on. I've really enjoyed our conversation.
Me too. Thank you.
This show just really gives you so much to talk about. And it's so great that we can chat with such interesting and insightful people in these conversations. Thanks again to Michael for chatting with us.
And also to our earlier guest, director Jeremy Podeswa.
Join us next time for the final episode of the Three Body Podcast for season one, where we'll be joined once again by showrunners David Benioff, Dan Weiss, and Alexander Wu to take a look at the final episode of the series.
We'll also be chatting to space engineer Barbak Fadosi, who acted as the engineering advisor on Three Body Problem. We'll dive into the science behind the final episodes of the series, taking a closer look at the Staircase Project.
See you then!